Today on Context, the Egyptian uprising and the struggle for democracy. With the Muslim Brotherhood now elected, we'll hear about the tensions in the country from Christians and Muslims. I'm Lorna Dueck, and you're watching Context, the show that looks at life beyond the headlines. The world watched in awe as 1 year ago, the Egyptian people began a revolution which spread through the Middle East. The early days of the Arab Spring saw millions of people demonstrate at Cairo's Tahrir Square. They wanted justice after three decades of increasing poverty and corruption under President Hosni Mubarak. The following months brought violent military attacks on protesters, Mubarak's resignation, and increased fear for the minority Christian population. Egyptians finally went to the polls, and the Muslim Brotherhood is now in power. Will Egypt become the democracy that hundreds of its people died for? And what's in store for its historically persecuted Coptic Christians? 1 year after the revolution, let's put it in context. Our first guest is Walid Phares, an author, professor, and Middle East expert. He briefs the U.S. Congress and the U.N. Security Council on matters related to international security and conflict. He's also the author of several books, including The Coming Revolution, which predicted the Arab Spring uprisings, and he joins us now from Washington. Thanks, Dr. Phares, for being with us.
Thank you for having me today on this issue.
Egypt's first free and fair election, 36 new political parties. Was the election truly democratic?
Well, the actual electoral process was, on the whole, democratic, meaning all the administrative measures were actually respected with some glitches right and left. But the actual education process of the voter, and more specifically those who were inclined to be secular and democratic, meaning non-Islamist, that process was not enough. Many of the voters didn't have enough time to either understand the agendas or some of the political forces, including the youth, women, minorities, Copts, were not given enough time to form their own political party. So what you have is one exercise, which was democratic, but the democratic culture needs way more exercises for Egypt to move from under authoritarianism to a pluralist democratic stage.
Okay, so what ended up happening is a majority of the seats went to the Islamic Party. 62% are either Muslim Brotherhood or Salafists. What does that mean?
Well, basically, when a majority of seats goes to the Islamists, should they be Muslim Brotherhood or Salafists, it meant that the other chunk of the voters didn't have enough time to organize into political parties, were not really supported and funded the way the Muslim Brotherhood were, didn't have media to support them the way the Islamists, including the Salafists, had in the Arab world. That means that the next government is going to be formed or dominated or at least influenced by the Muslim Brotherhood agenda. The question is going to be, will the next Islamist government in Egypt allow the seculars to organize themselves, to express themselves, so that in the next election cycle, they will have a chance, i.e. women, minorities, students, artists, and seculars in general, to come back and have a good representation.
Now, I was under the impression that this was a pious-driven vote, that those of us in the West didn't understand how deeply a love for Islam affects a vote. Was it that, or was it just familiarity?
Well, there is no doubt about it that a majority of the Muslims in Egypt, who are, Muslims are a majority of Egypt, more than 85% of the Egyptian people is Muslim, Sunni. The majority of those are pious. But then the issue is about, would they support an Islamist agenda? You can be pious, but yet not support a Islamist or even a Salafist, let alone a jihadist agenda. What has happened is that the Islamist coalition, that would be the Muslim Brotherhood, the Salafists, and their smaller allies, took advantage of the fact that the majority of Egypt's Muslims are pious, while those Muslims who are pious but secular and not organized didn't have enough time. So, yes, one can say that the West did not understand how the Islamic fundamentalists were able to take advantage of the short time for the Egyptian electorate to express themselves.
Reports say 100,000 Christians have left the country since last winter's revolution. Where are they going and why are they leaving? Those are big numbers.
These are extremely big numbers. The Christians of Egypt, known also as the Copts, are somewhere between 10, 15, some would even say more, percent of the population. We're talking about at least 15 million. That's the largest Christian community in the entire Middle East. Coptic leaders and NGOs, both in Egypt but also in the international community, have for many years stated that they have been suppressed and oppressed. And even with the collapse of the Mubarak regime and the success of the so-called Arab Spring, Copts have been attacked in Alexandria, in Cairo, in Upper Egypt. And Copts feel that it is not just the jihadi element or the extremist element, but even the military council suppressed them when they organized their own demonstrations. So because of this general feeling among the Copts that their future is very much under intimidation, tens of thousands have left. Others are preparing themselves to leave. They are joining other established communities in the United States, Canada, Australia, Europe, or beyond.
And what is your prediction for the future of democracy there in Egypt? Were we premature? Are we going to be looking at a stronger Sharia law? What's going to happen?
Well, knowing that the Muslim Brotherhood and the Salafists took advantage of this one breach that occurred in Egypt's authoritarian modern history to form the next government, if they are going to implement Sharia law the way they see it, it means that the freedoms of the Christian Copts, but also of the Muslims who are secular, those freedoms are going to shrink, which means that many Copts may consider to leave, and that would be a negative with regard to the presence of Christians in Egypt and in the Middle East. So what is important right now is that the international community will help Muslim seculars, humanists, Christian minorities in Egypt, and women as well, to coalesce, organize themselves, and basically ready themselves for the next round of elections to be better represented than in the last one. One election does not build democracy. It's a process, and that process needs the international support as well.
Okay, Walid Phares, thank you for joining us from Washington.
Thank you for having me.
Well, here in our studio audience, we have some Canadian Egyptians, and I want to ask, what has it been like following these events from afar? All right, let's start with this gentleman right here.
It has been like hell in Egypt for most of the Coptic Christians, of course, because with the fall of the regime that was there and very well entrenched for over 30 years, now with all of a sudden, the regime is down. The regime was not good to the Coptic people to start with, but now no regime. And still we have the Salafists and we have the extremists and the Islamists out in the open without any security, without police, without any protection from the military. And the Christians are very vulnerable, exposed to all these factions. The unwealthy Christians are stuck in a very bad situation. They have no right to file for claim refugees because the Canadian embassy in Egypt, they don't have the mandate to allow Christians of Egypt to file refugee claims from Egypt. They have to be outside of Egypt in order to do that. Okay. So this is an added hurdle.
We're going to come back to those issues. But after a quick break, I'll speak with a man who did leave Egypt hours before the uprising. He'll share his story and tell us how his faith helped him cope in difficult times.